What's going on, guys? Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to this Spring Boot Roadmap, where I'm going to take you through step by step exactly everything you need in terms of learning Spring Boot from a complete beginner to an advanced user. So we've been teaching Spring Boot, and a few days ago I've published the Spring Boot tutorial for beginners. So if you don't know much about Spring Boot, go and watch that video, so that gives you a good understanding of what Spring Boot is, what it offers. And also what we have is, so you see that this diagram, we have a blog on it on the website. So if you want to download this picture right here, maybe you want to bookmark it or you want to share, you can download on the website. I'll leave a link under the description of this video. And also, because we have a brand new platform, what we decided to do was to implement the roadmap feature. So let me show you. So in here, you can see that we have a bunch of roadmaps. So if you're into database, if you're into front-end development, full stack, Java, but here, have a look, we have Spring and Spring Boot. So if I actually show you this one, Java full stack, so this actually is a combination of all of the roadmaps that we have, but essentially you can see that we have a couple of courses in here, and it goes through Java, and then have a look, Spring framework, and then Spring Boot API, and then databases, and then we have Spring Data JPA, or actually even before that, databases, Spring Boot JPA, Flyway, Docker, AWS, front-end development, so on and so forth. So if you want to go through the roadmap as well, step by step, we have hours and hours and hours of courses for you on our new platform. All right, so to kick off things, in order for you to understand Spring Boot, you need to know Java. So either Java or Kotlin, depending which one that you're learning, it doesn't really matter. So you should be an engineer and not someone that's tied to a language. But in here, I've got Java. So obviously Java is the most popular one, and it's the one that I recommend. So here I would say go for Java 17 or 21. And then you need to know about OOP, exceptions, collections, Lambda, streams. And one which is very interesting, which is multi-threading and concurrency. Not like you don't need to know these days in depth as before, but still you need to be aware of what it is and how can you improve your application in case you need to. And then here I have records, sealed classes, pattern matching, and basically these are some of the advanced features, which they're not necessarily, but they're good to know. All right, so once you have the fundamental in here, also I do have a roadmap for this, which I'm gonna be recording a video, and also on the platform we have the Java masterclass that covers the Java programming language as well as IntelliJ. But once you have the language out of the way, then you can move to a build tool. So this is how you are going to structure your application, how you are going to bundle the application, how you are going to add dependencies to your application. So, you know, Spring Boot is a framework, so you need to add a dependency, Spring Boot Starter. And then with that, there's a bunch of other dependencies that you need to add. So knowing Maven or Gradle, and in here, it doesn't really matter which one you choose, they'll both achieve the exact same thing for learning purposes. Then moving on, now you can start to learn about Spring Core. So in here, there's a few things, but in a nutshell, what you mainly need to understand is dependency injection. So if you understand dependency injection, then we'll be fine. So then learning about the application context, bean life cycle, and Spring configuration. But basically, dependency injection is the main thing that you should be focusing on. So once you know Spring Core, so the Spring framework, now you can move into Spring Boot. So Spring Boot, it just makes it so easy for you to write, I would say mainly to build backend applications, RESTful APIs, which basically serve, you know, clients. And then I would say if you want to write a web application, for example, full stack, then you should be using React, for example, or Vue.js. But when it comes to Spring Boot, there's a few things like auto configuration, starter dependencies, profiles, configuration properties, running the application, which is knowing about the @SpringBoot annotation, Spring MVC. So this allows you to write RESTful APIs, and this is mainly what you're going to be using Spring Boot most of the times. Also, if you don't need to expose an API, you could still use Spring Boot, to be honest. And with Spring MVC, obviously, you need to know about HTTP, status codes, Java bean validation, so that you can remove a bunch of if statements. And I'll do a video on this, actually, which should be helpful to you guys. And then controller advice. So how do you handle exceptions globally, right? So you don't want to be catching these exceptions all over the code base and then throwing them and then not having full control of the response status codes that goes back to the clients, right? So you want to have a centralized place to handle all of this. Then moving on to data access, most of the times majority of the times you need to store data. So Spring Data JPA basically allows you to manage and access or interact with your database using repositories. So this has something to do with Hibernate, and basically Spring Data JPA, it just makes it super easy for you to interact with any underlying database. So here you've got stuff like lazy loading, transactions, flyway or leaky base for schema migration, and then you have entity relationships in here. So very important. How do you design your database, right? So how do you connect all of these entities together? DTO, making sure that you don't expose sensitive information to the clients, right? So if you have an entity, you don't want to expose that entity to the client. You want to have a DTO, data transfer object, that basically maps from one type to another, and then you send the data transfer object to the client. And then we have query methods. So this is mainly for more advanced queries, which you need to, write your custom queries, basically. All right. So knowing Spring Boot, knowing data access, now it's time for you to focus more on building RESTful API. So this is the core, to be honest. And actually, I have a duplicate in here, DTO. So DTOs, it really applies to data access as well as building RESTful APIs. But here you want to understand about controllers. So this is a class that handles all of your HTTP requests. Then you want to... handle exceptions, which I've mentioned in here as well, rate limiting and throttling. So, you want to make sure that you have full control of how often clients can hit your API. For example, request and response with DDOs, file uploads and downloads, paginations, as well as filtering. So DTO, actually, it's duplicate here, but I'll fix this so that you have a cleaner version of this diagram. All right, so then moving on, obviously, persistence plus databases. Here, you kind of choose one database of choice, Postgres or MySQL, and then you have Redis for caching or sessions. And this is very important also for testing, which I'll cover in a second. So test containers is a very popular choice for testing your queries. Then moving on, security, so Spring Security. And these are separate modules, actually, so data access, building RESTful API, security, which I spoke about in here. So these are dependencies that you add. And then you have, for example, security straight out of the box without having to configure much. So this is the beauty of Spring Boot. So JWT, I would say just understand what it is, and then have like a simple project with a login and logout, roles and authorities as well. So this is important. So you have a badge, for example, and this badge controls what access you can perform on certain resources. For example, maybe just read only, write only, so on and so forth. Then OAuth and OpenID Connect filters in here, and this allows you basically to write custom authentication. Cool. So this actually is a big topic. Security is a full course on its own, as well as data access. So we have a full course on this, Spring Boot as well, building RESTful APIs, testing, which is one of my favorites. So here, understanding, how to test your application using JUnit, Mockito, and then integration testing, right? So you know, testing the application as a whole instead of, you know, a single component, and test containers for database, mock MVC, and web test client. So this allows you to send HTTP requests within your classes for integration testing. Cool. So then here, if you are connecting to external clients, right? So you want to connect to external APIs. So understanding REST template, which is now legacy, to be honest. But nowadays, you just use WebClient, which is reactive. And we also cover all of this. Then as you follow through, and I was meant to play this beautiful animation in here that goes through, and you can see how beautiful it is. But as you go through in here, so DevOps and monitoring in here, how do you Dockerize your applications? So typically, you don't just deploy the jar, right? So before, we used to deploy the jar file, but nowadays we have Docker. So how do you Dockerize Spring Boot applications? Then actuator and micrometer. So this allows you to monitor, so expose metrics from your application, and then centralize logs. So understanding, for example, the Elk stack, Grafana, and Loki. And the here CI/CD with GitHub Actions. So how do you automate deployment, for example, CI, continuous integration, continuous deployment. And then as we move through in here, so cloud and deployment. So how do we take, let's say, the Docker image and then deploy it to the cloud, right? So maybe you want to use Elastic Beanstalk, for example, where you just give the Docker image, and then it's been, and then it creates all the infrastructure for your application. Or maybe you want to provision the infrastructure yourself. And then we also have Kubernetes. So Kubernetes, it's very, very interesting, but mainly for large applications. And I would advise, if you are starting a brand new application, don't even bother with Kubernetes, to be honest. There's no point. But you also have other options such as serverless, where there's no servers involved. And then obviously, moving towards the end in here, we have Spring AI, which, you know, nowadays everything is about AI. We also have reactive programming, messaging, RabbitMQ, Kafka, GraphQL, microservices, SSO with Keycloak and OAuth. And these are, you know, more advanced topics, which, just let me know which topic that you want me to create a, you know, comprehensive tutorial on it, or you want to learn more about, and I'll be more than happy to record a video on it. And I will record a video on where I've actually learned Spring Boot, and I get this question a lot, and I'll tell you how in the next videos to come. So make sure to subscribe to the channel, smash the like button, and if you want to grab this diagram, it will be available in the description of this video on the website. And this is all for now. I'll see you on the next one. Assalamu alaikum.